let's just go. An extra battery would be smart. Always carry an extra battery when you leave.
No, agreed. That's why you guys and the photographer are going to go first, and we will, and probably someone will shoot the rest, and then we'll follow.
What's up?
Two cups.
Double cup. Look at that.
Slow motion, we'll see how that goes. I like baby ducks, that's the motif for the wedding so far, baby ducks. We're getting deep meaning. So pool shots are only as good as the reaction shots and shots that you're contrasting it with. So I got some good stuff for the bride and groom. I want to kind of mix it up. We need to have a count for how many shots fired. So we're up to like 20 at this point. Let's see how far we can go.
All right.
How you doing?
Good, how are you?
Great, everything's great.
Any chance you know where the guys are located?
They were thinking about walking here from the Riverwalk, but they're probably waiting, probably 5 minutes, and that's behind me for the bus.
So, oh, okay, because y'all just came back. Yeah. Okay.
They should be here, I guess.
Okay, that's totally good. Okay, some pressures. Yes. Hey, Lucy, how are you? Oh, you might know the answer to this.
So how are we for them to finish?
They are in Francis Mirrors. Where the girls got married and they're on the table and all the girls got married. I'm thank you. That's a pleasure. Okay, so I was just going to get we were walking off the first 3 hours before we checked out. They go down into the camera discussing it.
Yeah, so they'll all be back on the list. Once we open the first, each one for the team, so they're in the audience to that team.
Where's my slide?
guys establishing with no one, I want one transition shot that will get me into people in the room, because it's kind of awkward when you shoot an empty room and then it's just suddenly full. And I want to show these ribbons, so... set up on the groom. Right here. A little wide, just because with the 4K I'll be able to punch in if I need to. I don't know where or what I want to be shooting with this backup camera. I'll be at the top, crouched low with the monopod shooting people as they come this way down the aisle. And then get guest reaction shots. And then I'll back up, back to this spot. Make sure that's set, it should be set. And then run back, set up with middle camera.
Thank you.
the door frame of there.
Okay.
I just wanted to make sure I wasn't stepping on your deal.
Oh, no.
The ceremonies are always a little stressful.
Thank you. gives this woman to be this man's wife?
I do.
Please be seated. Thank you so much for coming to celebrate today the marriage of Elizabeth Doring and Philip Exley. They're so happy to have you all here from all the different directions you've come and in different ways and the different people and the family and the friends. And it just shows what a great friend and family member these two are to have such a crowd here. And it's wonderful. And we're very happy to celebrate this day with them. Please take a moment now to consider, and then we'll have an opening prayer. Philip's grandmother, Marguerite Clark, passed away and would love to be here right now. I can guarantee that. We think about the strong impact she had on his life, as many of you have on him sitting here today. So let's take a moment to pray. Lord, thank you for this day. It's been anticipated and Lord, we thank you for even the little bit of trepidation with rain this morning and to clear it all out, for it to be wonderful for pictures and how Beth could be calm with that, as calm as she could be. Lord, please bless the rest of this day and their marriage. In Jesus' name, amen. John Exley is going to do a reading now.
How's it going, everyone? We're reading Ephesians 5, 23 or 25, 28 to 33. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. Thank you.
My wife Mary Beth and I have had the privilege to spend the past 6 months or so, mostly via FaceTime in preparation for today with Beth and Phil. It's been a tremendous time for us and one we'll always remember. It's been an unusually great time as we've been challenged with marriage and the different discussions of that within the pages of the Bible. And this has opened up many sincere and thoughtful conversations on marriage and life that have been helpful to us. Hopefully as much to them. And it's not that often that parents get that opportunity to spend that kind of close, intimate time with their children. So we're honored that they allowed us to do that, especially Beth, because he's heard from us for a long time. So we really feel honored to have had that opportunity. Thank you, Beth. So what is marriage? What is life in marriage according to God? And I can think of three words as we have this brief time here today to consider some things before we put the rings on one another. And the three words are purpose, hope, and endurance. And these are incredibly strong words. In the epistle of Paul to the Romans, by Paul to the Romans, chapter 5, we have in a few words, 84 to be exact, the answer to peace, to contentment within the hearts of the married couple and actually within the heart of anyone. Note, it doesn't promise all happiness. Sunny days, there can be some rain and unexpected times, and it doesn't promise fresh lattes at the village grind either. Sometimes life can be a grind, but it does promise understanding, help, comfort, contentment through the trials that will come. And he begins here. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations. That's interesting. We glory in tribulations. Sounds like a paradox. But we glory in tribulations. He says, why? Knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. The initial key is peace with God by being justified by faith. Here and only here is access into this place where we may stand and rejoice in hope. Hope, one of those three words, great word. When people lose hope, there's not much left. Hope is what can keep us all going no matter where we are. It's a great word. But not only this, he says we can glory in tribulations. That's an amazing statement, but he explains it's because you can understand that tribulation works patience. The difficulties you will pass through make you more patient with one another, and with others. This patience produces experience by passing through it. The experience, the troubles at work, with friends, with family, with hurt, with the death of a loved one, the death of a child. Hopefully that none of that happens. But we're not guaranteed anything. And the fear of getting past these is also a tribulation. But once we do get past them and we've gotten through them, it gives us a hope. And when you get this hope, it makes you not ashamed or beaten down by the issues of life to go forward into the next step or the next thing. And why is that? And he says, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. The most powerful thing in the world, as we close with this portion, the greatest proof of God in my mind as I get older, is simply the word love. Love has become to me the greatest proof. It's something that we all need. We're creatures made by him, and he is love. And love is the reason we're here today. Love is the most powerful thing in the world. To sense this, to experience God's life or love, will give you life, your marriage, the endurance to which no man can ever separate. The experience of God's love passes through you to each other. And that helps you to endure. In the Bible, Jesus Christ is referred to as the groom. Those who by faith at one point in their lives believe he is who he said he is, they consider his character, his values, his compassion as worthy of trust as their Savior. Then at that point, they say, I do. They become, as Scripture says, in the twinkling of an eye, one with him or his bride. A new life begins at that moment, continuing from that point throughout all eternity, a relationship which will never end, and this is a picture of that. What John read earlier was a biblical understanding in a short paragraph of what marriage here within time is to God. Every time you see a wedding, and here I do, you are placed in view of a picture that the Lord himself has placed before you to look at, to consider. This is the seriousness with which we all come to gather here and to celebrate the most blessed and of fulfilling relationships on earth, marriage, and then, Lord willing, family, which, of course, we hope for in good time. It all quite amazingly begins with, I do. This picture is what one must do to become one with him, to judge his character as worthy of trust that these two have done one to another. Not necessarily in such a formal place, but alone with him in the woods, at home, anywhere. I do. To be married in a sense to God. A marriage which never ends. A miracle. A mystery. And as John read in closing, so ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth it and cherisheth it, even as the Lord, the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. Phil, do you promise to have Beth as your wife?
I do.
Oh. It's okay. He really does.
Jumped
the gun. It's okay. To love her, to comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, forsaking all others, keep only unto her so long as you both shall live.
I do.
Beth, do you promise to have Phil as your husband, to love him, comfort him, honor him, and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep only unto him so long as you both shall live?
I do.
Okay, you can face each other. Phil, repeat after me. I, Phil, commit myself to you, Beth.
I, Phil, commit myself to you, Beth.
From this day until death do us part.
From this day until death do us part.
With God at our realm.
With God at our helm.
Sorry. I vow to love you unconditionally.
I vow to love you unconditionally.
To lead you and to serve you.
To lead you and to serve you.
To honor you and to protect you.
To honor you and to protect you.
To pursue you and to know you more completely each day.
To pursue you and to know you more completely each day.
I vow to be yours through sickness and in health.
I vow to be yours through sickness and in health.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
I vow to prioritize God in our marriage.
I vow to prioritize God in our marriage.
To seek him alone and jointly with you.
To seek him alone and jointly with you.
And to trust his calling for you, for me, and for us.
And to trust his calling for you, for me, and for us.
I vow to share my heart with you.
I vow to share my heart with you.
To encourage you in all your endeavors.
To encourage you in all your endeavors.
And to remind you how beautifully made you are.
And to remind you how beautifully made you are.
That's the truth. Okay. I vow to share my heart with you.
I vow to share my heart with you.
To encourage you in all your endeavors.
To encourage you in all your endeavors.
And to always honor you.
And to always honor you.
Phil, place this ring on Beth's finger and repeat after me. With this ring, I pledge myself to you and you alone as your faithful husband.
With this ring, I pledge myself to you alone.
And to you alone.
You alone as your faithful husband.
Maybe too long.
Okay.
And to serve you as a reminder of the covenants we have made here today.
And to serve as a reminder of the covenants we have made here today.
Before God, our family, and our friends.
Before God, our family, and our friends.
May we always lean on the gospel of Jesus Christ.
May we always lean on the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Through the challenges ahead.
Through the challenges ahead.
And forever remember the blessings he has granted us.
And forever remember the blessings he has granted us.
Beth, place the ring on Phil's finger and repeat after me. With this ring, I pledge myself to you and you alone as your faithful wife.
With this ring, I pledge myself to you and you alone as your wife.
And to serve as a reminder of the covenants we have made here today.
And to serve as a reminder of the covenants we have made here today.
Before God, our family, and our friends.
Before God, our family, and our friends.
May we always lean on the gospel of Jesus Christ.
May we always lean on the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Through the challenges ahead.
Through the challenges ahead.
And forever remember the blessings he has granted us.
And forever remember the blessings he has granted us.
By the power vested in me by God, I now pronounce you man and wife. Phil, you may kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, I now present to you Mr. and Mrs. Philip Arthur Exley.